body. I mean, as you see, I'm an Indian, and though I've been living in Germany for the last 20 or more years, I'm still very much rooted in the South Asian democratic scene. And so I think what I'll be sharing with you today will be bringing a perspective of the issues of women and peace from a Southern perspective. I must say that I'm overwhelmed to be here and facing so many young people who are very eager and dynamic, and I really hope I do justice to all of you. Now, briefly about the German National Committee UN Women. Our offices are in Bonn. We have a very small office with 3 staff members and 7 board members, and all of us work together to actually make our presence known. Now, UN Women, as such, I talk about the United Nations Organization for Women, with its headquarters in New York, was founded in 2010. Before that, it was founded by the General Assembly meeting, and the full name is United Nations Entity for Gender Equality and the Empowerment of Women. Now, one can see the United Nations and the UN Women as a kind of a club where the heads of the member states sign, and in signing, they pledge and they are obliged to implement the UN resolutions taken at the General Assembly in their own nations. And that's why the UN organization, in spite of all its pros and cons, is the only organization we have at the global level to speak out loud and clearly the needs of women. Now, before the formation of UN Women, there were 4 separate independent women's organizations. There were namely Division for the Advancement of Women, that is DAW, International Research and Training Institute for the Advancement of Women, which is INSTRO, Office of the Special Advisor on Gender Issues and Advancement of Women, OSAVI, and the United Nations Development Fund for Women, that is UNIFEM. Now, all these 4 organizations came under the umbrella of the United Nations Development Programme. So, as such, there was always a shortage of funds, especially for UNIFEM. The other 3 organizations were involved in studies, in research, and advocacy and activism. Whereas UNIFEM was the only organization which was involved in supporting as well as encouraging women's development programs at the grassroots level. Today, the main roles of UN Women are to support intergovernmental bodies, such as the Commission on the Status of Women, in their formulation of policies, global standards, and norms. So in Germany, the Commission for the Status of Women, please correct me if I don't get the name correctly, it is the Frauenrechtskommission. The word status has been translated as Recht, which is Rights, Women's Rights Commission. And this, of course, causes a little problem. I find that when I communicate with my board members, my friends and colleagues, there is always this understanding, how do you understand rights and status? So for my own understanding, I say rights are needed, they are important, and they are the stepping stones for having a better status in the society. The second point is to help member states to implement these standards, standing ready to provide suitable technical and financial support to those countries that request it, to forge effective partnerships with civil society. So you find the UN works with governmental agencies and the civil society. Today, those of you who are familiar with civil society know civil societies have come to stay. Governments and the private sector cannot dwell with them, and the voice is becoming louder, and they bring with them the demands, the needs, and the dreams of the people. The third point is to hold the UN system accountable for its own commitments on gender equality, including regular monitoring of system-wide progress. For many years, the UN has faced serious challenges in its efforts to promote gender equality globally, including inadequate funding and no single recognized driver to direct UN activities on gender equality issues. Now, according to the Charter of the United Nations of Women, it works, amongst other things, for five main, you can sort of call it the main goals, or the five main priorities of UN Women are to increase women's leadership and participation, ending violence against women and girls, engaging women in all aspects of peace and security, enhancing women's economic empowerment, and making gender equality central to national development, planning, and budgeting. In addition to this, we have a body called CEDAW, that is United Nations Committee on the Elimination of Discrimination Against Women. This is an expert body. It was established in 1982 and is composed of 23 experts on women's issues around the globe. Now, these experts come not only from the government bodies and government agencies, but they are women activists and representatives of women NGOs involved in development work. So you see that when you talk of women, you're just not talking about ideologies and rights, but you're linking it up with grassroots reality. So it cuts across all strata of society, whether, in South Asia, they're very fond of using this term, whether they are the higher class, university-educated women, or whether they are the poor women who are agricultural laborers in the village. Now, the mandate of CEDAW is specific. It watches over the progress for women made in those countries that are states parties to the 1979 Convention on the Elimination of All Kinds of Violence Against Women. So, as I mentioned before, by ratifying to this convention, the states accept a legal obligation to work actively against discrimination of women. So this is in brief about the formation of UN Women in 2010 and its link. One thing I would like to say is that UN Women has to raise its own funds to implement its norms and goals and programs. And that is why it set up these national committees, and it has 15 national committees all over the world. And it is the task of these national committees to raise funds for UN Women. Now, there are two kinds of funds in UN Women. One is the Core Fund, and the second one is the UN Trust Fund. In the UN Trust Fund, we can raise money for specific issues. It could be women for peace, it could be women violence against women, or it could be even the recent Ebola epidemic. And when we raise money on these issues, then we send it to New York, and it goes to the Trust Fund, and it is used only for that purpose for which it is raised and for that particular organization. Whereas the Core Fund is a more general fund, and the Core Fund allows the UN Women to disperse this fund according to its own discretion and need. So the Core Fund gives UN Women a little more freedom on how these funds are used. In the last 3 years, we have found that it is relatively easy, I say relatively easy, to raise funds for specific issues than Core Funds. Now, I'll share a few thoughts of mine on women and peace. I mean, recent past, we find that there's a couple negotiating for peace during war and post-war conflict. I'll start with a quotation made declared by the former UN Secretary General, Mr. Kofi Annan, in 2002, while he presented the UN report on women, peace and security, said, "There is no society in which women have the same status as men," which means that there's a lot of work for all of us to do globally, cutting across language, race, religion, to see that there is the same status for both men and women. Because I'm a firm believer, a society which confers dignity upon its women, respect on its women, is a society that has a firm base to develop and go further. Today, there is a worldwide movement of women and men campaigning for gender justice, for the universal application of human rights, and for conflict resolution. And activists know that armed conflicts are also related to unjust gender relations. Gender, as we know, is a social category, as opposed to the biological character sex, which means gender relations, concept of gender, or how women see themselves as women, or how men see themselves as women, which enables them to relate to each other, is a learned behavior, is a social characteristic, and what is learned can also be unlearned. Maybe not so simple, but it can be unlearned. And that is what we're trying to say, that before the eyes of law, in a society, men and women are equal. Now, here I would like to introduce the concept of human security. The idea of human security was developed by the United Nations in the mid-1990s. It comes close to the security concepts developed by feminist peace studies. For instance, it promotes an understanding of power that stresses the idea of having power to do something rather than having power over somebody. I mean, it's very clear, to do something, the power to do something, you cooperate. Whereas having power over somebody is oppression and exploitation. The feminist concept of human security, in addition, demands that security for women and girls must not stop at the front door of their homes. I think many of us have heard that saying that what happens in the home, what happens in the family, is private sphere, no? But it's the public sphere, which is different and we can address. But I think today, we see that one really cannot draw a sharp line between the two, that the public and the private sphere are interrelated. For women and girls in zones of war and crisis, the issue is personal safety, protection from sexual violence, protection from deportation, freedom of movement, food, and access to clean drinking water, health and hygiene. Now, in 1995, we had a historical international conference for women in Beijing, which resulted in a platform called the Beijing Platform for Action. And it's historical in the sense it was the first massive gathering where you had about 17,000 representatives from the government sector and more than double the amount of women from the activists and development workers who came together. And from this meeting came forth what today is popularly known as the Beijing Platform for Action, a declaration which identified 12 areas of concern for women and girls across the globe. That is poverty, power sharing, education and training, health, human rights, violence against women, institutional mechanisms, peace and armed environment, media, economic justice, and focus on girl child. Now, linked to this is the famous resolution, that is the United Nations Security Council resolution on, which is called as 1325. Civil society organizations from the South and the North have provided an important impetus for a gender equal, economically sustainable, and peaceful world. UN Resolution 1325 has played a central role in peace policy. Excuse me, I have to use a bit more time. The UN Resolution 1325 was adopted in the year 2000, and it followed the Beijing Conference. And as I said, it didn't happen in one day. Before that, there was more than a decade of hard work and lobbying by women activists, feminists of all kinds, and women development workers, including what is not mentioned, but I must mention it, including NGOs which were directed by men, but who had a very strong bias towards the promotion of women's equality and the status of women. I say that because I worked in the organization, which was headed by a man, and we did a lot in India for the Beijing Conference. In the summer of 2008, UN Resolution 1820 was added, and according to this resolution, all forms of sexual violence was penalized as crimes against humanity, and in extreme cases, even as war crimes. 1325 provides that women be adequately represented on all levels in peace-building processes and in the making of security policies. UN member states are urged to take into account the different living conditions of men and women in wartime and post-war situations. The responsibility doesn't end when war stops. So often it is seen that the work, the peace-building work, requires more effort. And so it stresses that not only in war situations, but also in post-war situations. Women and girls must be protected from sexual violence, and the contents of this resolution can be summed up by the three P's. That is participation, prevention, and protection. UN Resolution 1325 is a historical breakthrough for the international women's peace movement. In 2000, the pioneering UN Security Council Resolution 1325 recognized that war impacts women differently and stressed the need to increase women's participation in peace talks. UN Women's Programs on Women, Peace and Security engage women in all aspects of negotiations, peace building, and reconstruction to build inclusive societies. It trains peacekeepers to detect, address, and stop conflict-related sexual violence, and at the same time supports the reform of justice and security institutions and ensures that public services are fully responsible to women's needs. 14 years since the adoption of Security Council Resolution 1325 in 2000, significant progress has been made on the women, peace and security agenda. There is growing recognition that women's empowerment is a key ingredient for democracy, stability and lasting peace. Yet, the increased violence, mass displacement and humanitarian catastrophes in the past year have have a detrimental impact on the security of women and children, particularly girls, hindering progress towards achieving peace, security, reconciliation, and stability for all. Now, I need not stress upon the importance of sustainable peace. Sustainable peace needs women's leadership and representation at all levels of decision making. You know, it has been the practice and continues even today that in such talks, you have a woman or two, it's like a kind of, oh yes, we have women, but this has to stop and there have to be equal number of women and men at such an outdated conference negotiating peace and planning for societies after war. That is, women must be full participants in peace negotiation, monitoring and implementation of peace agreements, post-conflict plannings, peacekeeping missions, recovery programs, government and parliaments, security and justice sectors, administration of public services, and transitional justice. I just want to say something about transitional justice because we hear about this quite often, and some of us wonder what is this all about? What is trying to do? Is it some special kind of laws? Something special? So just to sort of tell you what it is. It is an approach for achieving justice in times of transition from conflict and or state repression. By trying to achieve accountability and redressing victims, transitional justice provides recognition of the rights of victims, promotes civic trust, and strengthens the democratic rule of law. One of the most famous and important examples of transitional justice is the Truth and Reconciliation Mission, spearheaded by Bishop Tutu in South Africa after apartheid was defeated. So this actually entails hearing the stories of victims or survivors of all kinds of violence, especially of violence, and getting the perpetrators to listen to that and being able to look into the eyes of their victims. So this highly emotionally charged situation, and I have heard a few of these sit-ins, very moving, there's a lot of tear shedding, but it's only then there is forgiveness and there is reconciliation. So, and that is why transitional justice becomes very important, and you'll find that there have been attempts made by various organizations from Europe, even in Germany, for instance, America Mondial, where in the Democratic Republic of Congo, they brought the survivors of violent rape and perpetrators to sit together to talk, and so that they know that what they have done to this woman is just more than physical and bodily invasion, it was a crushing of the spirit, and actually robbing them of their dignity. And dignity can only be restored when the perpetrators recognize this. Now, sexualized violence in Eastern Congo. Over a decade of fighting in the Eastern Democratic Republic of Congo has decimated the government and healthcare infrastructure in this region, creating some of the worst health infrastructure in the world. I mean, if you look into the statistics, health statistics of this region, you find it has some of the worst rates for what has happened to women, for the increase in HIV, as well as other sexually transmitted infections. One of the most vicious and salient features of this conflict is the widespread sexual violence being perpetrated on the women of Eastern DRC. I'm going to skip in 2007, United Nations Undersecretary General for Humanitarian Affairs, John Holmes, called rape in the DRC as the worst in the world. In the same sentiment, the then US Secretary of State Hillary Clinton called rape in the region as one of mankind's greatest atrocities against women. Now, we find that war today, the 21st century, is different from war in the last century. We find that it is no more just a conflict between two nations or two power structures which engage in military struggle, but what happens today is war has moved out of these regions, this arena, into the villages, into civilian, erstwhile civilian populations, resorting to arms, taking up arms, and so it's just not military that you have to deal with when you have to put an end to war. It is also to men and women as well who take up armed conflict and the local militia. Now, of course, there are many reasons, many analyses why did this happen, especially in Africa. You find the whole Central African region is chaotic. There's constant strife, armed strife, and we hear of this being reported as ethnic strife. But I want all of you to think, is it really ethnic? If you look further down, you find that there is always a material need. It could be land, it could be not having the rightful share in the resources of the country, and what is not so openly talked about is the colonial past, where the nation states in countries where previously nation states did not exist, they were formed by taking a pencil and a ruler and drawing the national boundaries. So these boundaries cut across, they split ethnic groups or groups living in a certain area occupying a certain piece of land, or they split nomadic groups, which has added to the conflict we see today. Then I shall briefly touch upon rape as a weapon of war. Now, a study by the Harvard Humanitarian Initiative in 2009 on sexual violence in DRC shows characteristics, and the study shows characteristics which may show that rape has been used as a weapon. But since I'm not the author of the study and only using, I would say, rape has been used as a technique to subdue and strike terror in a group of people for the armed actor's own interests. And how can you say that rape is used as a weapon? It's used as a weapon when the perpetrators deliberately use it as a strategy, in that they don't choose the victim of the rape and say, well, you're a beautiful woman and so, but there is no bar on age. The young, the old, the very old, they're raped and gang raped. And sometimes they are raped in front of their own families, with their own men. And so it's just, the individual woman suffers, as well as the community suffers. The men see that they have been helpless to protect their women, which causes shame. And slowly over a period of time, a community is destroyed. So when rape is used as a strategic weapon in war, it destroys, along with its women, a whole community and the very social fabric of the community is destroyed. And added to this, to come out of rape is the social stigma. And in this study, women have reported saying that it has been more hard for them to rise above the social stigma than the trauma of the rape itself. Now, 1325 resolution by itself is a very powerful tool, but it's the second resolution that is the resolution 1820, very clearly identifies sexual violence as a threat to world peace and security, and as a tactic of war used to dominate, to humiliate, terrorize, and displace civilian populations. So this resolution places sexual violence clearly on the agenda of the United Nations Security Council, identifying such violence as a security issue and recognizing that in extreme forms it can constitute war crimes, crimes against humanity, and even acts of genocide. Now, I would like you to think, you know, where did this resolution come from? I mean, I couldn't have guessed it myself. This resolution was put forth by the then US Secretary of State, Ms. Condoleezza Rice. Now, okay, some of us may like her, some of us may not like her, and we may also say, what was her motive? But I really don't care about that. She put forth this resolution, and it has come to stay. And we can work with both these resolutions taken together to a better status of women, to better peace and security policies, and to a peaceful and sustainable world. Now, very briefly, I would like to touch upon feminist perspectives on peace. Now, feminist perspectives of peace are based on the premise of a universal integration of a gender perspective and equal participation of men and women, especially in security and peace policies. Now, if you take this together with the declaration from the Beijing platform, we find that the member states are called to support mainstreaming of a gender justice perspective in all policy areas at all levels of government. So, this together with the feminist gender perspective, if you introduce the term gender justice, we find that it is an almost foolproof understanding of feminist peace. That on one hand you have a women's peace and you bring in gender justice and gender mainstreaming. So in her book, Gender in International Politics, the US scholar Judith Ticker, she, apart from talking about gender mainstreaming, gender justice, and women's role in the whole area of peace and security, he says that there has to be a focus on the human need for community, solidarity, and interdependence. A positive security assumes an interrelationship of violence at all levels. So violence does not exclude any social strata, any country, any group of people. So it cuts across. And in this sense, it becomes a dynamic concept which strives for gender justice as well as order, and is favorable to women's full and equal participation in international politics. Now, I do not want to say what gender mainstreaming is all about, because most of you know it, and you know that gender or today's world under the patriarchal system affects both men and women. So, but what I would like to do is to give an example from our own work experience and work background. When we started going out and to the villages in late 70s and 80s in India, it was of course, India had a lot of charismatic people, and in South India, we had an ex-Jesuit from Spain, and we refer to him even today as Father Ferrer. He chose India's worst and backward and rural area, not far from Bangalore, has the worst climate. He, and together with his wife Anne Ferrer, they started working in the villages. His approach was educate every child and the girl or boy. At the time, we had other people who came from extremely Marxist background, and they said, no, we have to build people's organizations. So my organization, the founder is late, Mr. Martin Kurian, said that we have to form people's organizations, and we have to form women's federations, women's organizations, and men's organizations. So here you have the segregation of the two groups. But there's another organization which is called ADATS, again not from not far from Bangalore, which believe, this group of young people believe, no, we have to organize people according to their labor. So if we organize landless laborers, we organize men or women, they are first landless labor. So to me, this is gender mainstreaming at a time when this word did not exist. And when I was preparing for this talk, I said, no, I have to share it to the group of young people that we didn't call it gender, but we felt that if you organize people on their professional, that is here, landless agricultural laborers, fighting for equal wages, fighting for health leave, health privileges, it's the same for both men and women. Now, I would like to give you another example, also from South Asia, from India, of a region that faces armed conflict. And in this case, the armed conflict is within the country itself from the Indian Army. And this is in the northeast region of India. On the south, it borders Bangladesh. To the east, it borders Burma. And then you go further north, it's China. And this region, I'm sorry, I don't have a map, but if you just try to picture, you have Bangladesh. And there is a little triangular part jutting out. And on the north, you have China and Burma and Nepal. And it's a very narrow, they call it the chicken's neck. It's a narrow strip of land which connects this remote region to main India. Now this region has seven states, so often Indian newspapers report this as the problem of the seven sisters. And earlier during the British rule, this area was inhabited by tribes. They are ethnically different, and in the southern region, the state of Manipur, you had princedom. This princedom, I'm concentrating on the state of Manipur. The state of Manipur is unique because the dominant group of this state are the Maitis. The Maitis are not a tribal group. Their religion, they belong to within the Hindu fold of, or the Hindu philosophy of life. And the king came from this group. They live in the valley of Imphal, which is less than 10% usable land of the whole state. The rest of the state is thickly forested, and the dominant tribe of this region are the Nagas. And at the time of British occupation, when independence of India was being discussed, and the division of states, there was a lot of unrest, and the Nagas, even to this day, dream of a greater Nagaland. And the greater part of this Nagaland lies in Burma. I was talking to my young friend from Burma yesterday, who also said that this is a very backward region and a poor region. But so you have a group that is spread over two countries, they have this dream. And during the British rule, they all asked for, they demanded a separate Naga land. But there's a third group called the Kukis. The Kukis were a nomadic group. When they came from somewhere in the northern part of Cambodia or Thailand, nobody knows, but they were a nomadic group. So when they entered the region, the Nagas gave them land to till, thinking they will go away. But I have yet to hear anybody leaving a land and going away. No. Once land is given, you settle down, you build your village, and you grow. And so today they live too close to each other. There's a constant fight over land, and matters have escalated. And for more than 10 years, the Indian Army has stepped in. And of course, this region is politically very sensitive because of Indo-China relations. And they imposed an act which is called as the Armed Forces Special Powers Act. Now, under this act, a soldier can do anything and he will not be taken to task. You know, he can shoot an innocent person and say, short an encounter, but this is the reality. And it's amidst this reality, we have donor agencies who were supporting development projects in this region found that they could not carry out development activities of providing shelter, food, clothing, and education, and something had to be done. And here again, I would like to say that the relations, at least that time, between donors and workers, they had common aims, they shared common concerns, and very often it is that people who click together, who share interests, also build. And it was in this background that representatives from Nagas, the Maitis, and Kukis met in 1994, not in Manipur because it was too dangerous. If such a meeting was seen by the army, they would shut down the meeting under this act. And the first talks of reaching across ethnic conflicts, of identifying common needs, of identifying ways and means to establishing peace has begun. And then I was in India together with my husband, who was then a consultant for this organization, and that's how this began. These 3 years, we continued meeting with representatives. In the first meeting, we had only one woman representative. She came from the Kuki tribe. And at the end of 3 years, it rose to 5, and we were able to meet, not exactly in Manipur, but in the neighboring state of Assam, which is still close. The people were able to sit with each other, not only talk, but listen. The Nagas could listen to the Kukis, the Maitis could listen. And it's not, I mean, when I talk to you, it sounds easy, but in reality, it wasn't. And when we returned, this area was taken up by a colleague, my husband's colleague, who's again a wonderful young German woman from Red for the World, who saw the potential of this network, built on it, and today the United NGO Mission for Manipur, it's a small network, it's a powerful network, comprising of representatives from all these three groups, and it works together with the Mighty Mothers Union, with the Kuki Women's Association, with the Baptist Church, which is very active, because under this Armed Forces Medical Powers Act, women have taken up to patrolling their neighborhoods with torches so that their neighborhood is safe. If anything happens to a girl, the mothers join together and see. They are able to protest. And the importance of this network was very clearly seen when some years ago, I think it's around 2007 or 2008, in one donor meeting and the network meeting in a remote village in Manipur close to Burmese border, one of the male colleagues was kidnapped. He was kidnapped, and it was because of the women's unions, they are called the Kuki Women's Union and Maiti Women's Union, together with the United NGO Mission of Manipur and what I call the faith-based organization, that is the organization of the Baptists, because most of the Kukis have become Christians, were able to get the release of this colleague within a matter of 4 weeks. And I think with this, I'll bring my input to an end. And well, if there are any questions or any clarifications, I hope I can answer them. I mean, I don't have to answer them because many of these thoughts are already present amongst you, and you can also comment and contribute to the same.